So the number of joiners has now begun to calm down. So I think we'll kick off now. My name's Tom Townsend. I'm the partner leading the financial crime proposition at GT. And I'm welcomed. I'm joined by Fran Murray and Lord Hogan-Howe from Rosenblatt, who are going to be, or we're all going to be speaking about topical financial crime issues of the moment. And as I say, we do want it to be something that is participative, and we do want your interaction, and we'll be using Slido, slido.com, hashtag fincrime. So at various points through this session, there will be, I think there's three or four questions where you might get to make a contribution. And of course, those are anonymous, so we're using them for an interactive poll, as the messaging says. If you want to, if you can see those, the slides there, it's very easy to use. You can do it on your mobile phone whilst you're listening to the speakers, and get your chance to have a say. Thanks, Emma. So I'm going to hand over now to Fran Murray from Rosenblatt, who's going to take us through some of the topical financial crime issues. She'll be followed by Lord Hogan-Howe. We're very, very pleased to have both of them at this session today. And then I'll be, as consultants tend to do, like to have the last word. You see what I did there? So I will be finishing off the session. It might be that it's appropriate to have some questions to route. If you've got a really burning question, if you could use the hand up function, and then I can type to manage that and compare that. So if you've got a question for Fran, if you could put your hand up, and then I can invite you to ask your question, because we are keen to have some participation. That's all I've got to say for the moment, Fran. So I think it's over to you.
Thank you very much, Tom. Thank you, everybody, for joining us this morning. This is the second session in Series 2 of the Grant Thornton Rosenblatt Financial Crime Webinar Series. As Tom said, we will be taking you through a number of topical areas with regard to financial crime. If we go to the next slide, please. So I'm Fran Murray. I assisted in founding the Financial Crime Department for Rosenblatt. Lord Bernard Hogan-Howe is the advisor to Rosenblatt's Financial Crime Department. We deal with both defence and private prosecutions in relation to high-value, multi-jurisdictional, multi-handed fraud. This can be anything from boiler room fraud, VAT fraud, pension fraud, and any other fraud you can think of. We also cover areas including bribery and corruption, sanctions, export controls, and regulatory issues, which I'll be taking you through as I go into my slides. You can see here set out a roadmap of the topic areas I intend to cover. For those of you that joined me in the autumn last year, I did cover COVID-related frauds, which I will be going through this morning, as well as push payments. I will be looking at export controls, sanctions, and PEPs, as they are very topical at the moment, as well as suspicious activity reports and recent cases that are filtering through the criminal justice system. Next slide, please. So, COVID-19 related frauds, they have changed. They are changing month by month, sometimes week by week, dependent on what's happening. And that this time round, it's vaccines. So criminals are exploiting the national rollout of the COVID vaccine programme. It's done in a number of ways. It could be done via vishing, which is telephone calls, smishing, which are text messages, with links to fake and convincing NHS websites, requesting certain details in order to receive the vaccination. This is also done by email. By the 7th of January 2021, Action Fraud had received 57 reports in relation to the COVID-19 vaccine. One such phishing email purportedly sent by the NHS at the end of January was asking victims to supply bank card details if you receive one of these kind of phishing or smishing communications. It's a scam. So avoid it. Don't click the link. The fraudster They're asking for details in order to exploit your sensitive data for other means, ordinarily theft. Next slide, please. So our first poll this morning, as Tom said, if you visit slido.com and enter hashtag FinCrime, you will be able to participate with the first poll of this morning's session. Have you or someone you know been the victim of vaccine fraud? I.e., have you been sent communications requesting details in return for a vaccination? The vaccination scheme rolled out at the beginning of the year. Fraudsters hit the ground running and were circulating various communications. So it's highly likely you may have received one of these. Oh, actually, 24% of you have, so that's relatively low, with 76% of you not receiving one of these communications. That's not to say that you may receive one over the coming months.
I think that's one that targets the elderly particularly as well, isn't it?
Absolutely. Absolutely,
the vulnerable.
Yeah. So if we move to the next slide, please. Bounce back loan fraud. I've had a number of inquiries with regard bounce back loan fraud. Obviously, law enforcement are investigating. There are active investigations ongoing. No prosecutions as yet, but there have been a series of arrests in relation to high value bounce back loan frauds. It's likely law enforcement will be wanting to cherry pick a number of high value cases of this nature to act as a deterrent and or to make an example and or to demonstrate that law enforcement are actively prosecuting individuals and corporates for these crimes. So the bounce back loan scheme was launched in May 2020 to allow SMEs to mitigate the effects of the pandemic by securing loans of between £2,000 and £50,000. There's no interest required or repayments on the loan for the first 18 months of the six-year term. As of the 17th of December 2020, more than £43.5 billion had been lent under the scheme to 1.4 million companies. And that was far more than was anticipated when the scheme was originally launched. A report by the Public Accounts Committee in December 2020 suggested the shortcomings in the scheme's design have exposed taxpayers to significant losses. And ergo, the reason law enforcement will want to ensure there are some prosecutions resulting in convictions, confiscation proceedings, in an effort to recoup finances that have been lost through the scheme. In January 2021, three men were the latest to be arrested in connection with bounce back loan fraud in the National Crime Agency investigation into fraudulent claims of £6 million. That's one of the largest that has been reported to date. This was believed to have been made through falsifying data and documents. Next slide, please. So this is a case study. At the moment, it's not clear whether this is going to be a criminal prosecution, but it was very recently publicised in the media. There was a search for limited companies for sale on eBay and Gumtree, and it brought up dozens of firms for sale at prices of between £900 and £9,000. Undercover newspaper investigations revealed that the seller, Shiraz Mukhtir, had two companies for sale on eBay, one for just £1,000 because it didn't have a business account. The seller advised the purported buyer to set up a business account before fraudulently applying for the loans and agreed to make them the director of the firm as soon as he was paid. This obviously illustrates the way in which the alleged fraudster, have been using and/or manipulating the bounce back loan scheme in order to receive funds that they are not entitled to.
Fran, it's quite interesting. The Treasury Select Committee before Christmas, I think it was, and subsequently had all of the banks on. I know there's both banks and bank representatives, financial service firms, and lawyers on the call with a number of those. Asked questions about their process for onboarding onboarding in inverted commas customers. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. There are also some, just by the by, in some interesting figures in there around how much of these loans have actually been spent. There was a figure in there saying that of the amount, total amount loaned, they're estimating that 50% of it, particularly I think with the established banks, hasn't actually been spent. It's on deposit at the banks of whom the customer who's taken the loan. So it's quite, there's some quite interesting things and dynamics at play.
And I'm sure a number of the loans were applied for without actually needing them. Hence why, or a business has applied for a loan and decided to revamp their company with the use of the loan that they may not have actually needed. Next slide, please. So clone firm scams, for those of you that keep an eye on the Financial Conduct Authority website and action fraud, there have been a number of instances of clone firm scams. These are scams whereby attractive investment propositions are made, but in actual fact you are not investing in the firm as it presents. You're investing in a firm that has been hijacked by fraudsters. The clone firms are set up by criminals using the name, address and firm reference number to give it an air of authenticity. They will entice victims with marketing material and contact them claiming to work for the firm and promising modest returns on investments. This often leads to victims transferring funds to fraudsters in relation to investments such as cryptocurrency, bonds, pensions, shares, and so on. Between March and April 2020, at the beginning of the lockdown and the pandemic period, the reported scams increased by 29%. Victims lost more than 78 million. 77% of investors either did not know or were unsure what a clone firm was, even when they were contacting the Financial Conduct Authority with the firm reference number that the FCA were confirming it was an authentic firm, and therefore the investor was making the investment. So due diligence is key here, and be extra vigilant. If it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. Next slide, please. So our second poll this morning, if you haven't already, go to slido.com and insert hashtag FinCrime. Have you or someone you know been the victim of a clone investment scam in the past year? So have you been susceptible to a scam or an investment proposition that looks very enticing, which has materialised? Or you may not know yet, you may have invested and you haven't appreciated, as a lot of the time these things aren't uncovered until many months down the line.
That's one of the awful things about these ones, Fran, isn't it? Don't always know. And some of the financial service firms I speak to, where say, for instance, a bond is sold in their name to somebody who isn't even their customer. And so they're the people that get the first call asking about their investment. And of course, you know, there is pretty much no recourse to that firm. I wouldn't say no recourse, but, you know, that firm is kind of left with somebody who isn't their customer phoning them up about an investment that doesn't exist. And it's not a great situation for anybody concerned. And, you know, lots of the financial service firms are concerned about, you know, the vulnerable people that are getting caught by that.
Yeah,
it's a very, very difficult situation.
It is, and it would be interesting to see what provisions are put in place going forward to prevent this happening, and what other due diligence can be done, and what the firms can do to protect themselves from cloning in the first instance.
Also, you know, it probably is one that I know wider groups are trying to, you know, those especially with the fake websites, trying to find ways in which those can be more quickly shut down than is currently the case, and also trying to engage with the social media firms where sometimes the links to those false firms or the claim firms is a kind of sourced from where the customers are kind of clicking a link and going through to a website. So I know there's steps to try and impact that as much as possible, but at the moment it isn't one that has been solved for sure.
Quite. Well, it appears from our audience that only 7% of you have been the victim or know somebody that has been the victim of a clone investment scam, which is good news. I won't sound too doom as to anything undiscovered.
For a group of lawyers and financial services professionals, I suppose that is good news.
It is indeed.
But I think it's worth saying that in the modern conception, I know the FCA has published something on vulnerability at the moment. You know, the modern conception of vulnerability possibly does need looking at, because this as that 7% shows, an audience like this, you know, sometimes does get caught out in points of vulnerability mm-hmm. by this type of thing.
Yeah, they are more and more sophisticated. So moving on to authorised push payments, for those of you that tuned in autumn last year, I touched on this during the financial crime session. What is it? An authorised push payment scam is where a victim willingly transfers money to the scammer. There's no legal protection for a customer who transfers their money in an APP. Innocent victims who use banks that have signed up to the APP voluntary code may be entitled to be reimbursed. Next slide, please. And an interesting case that Tom and I have discussed previously is the Barclays case with regards to an APP, where in fact a scammer posed as an FCA employee conducting investigation and manipulated the victim into transferring £700,000 and her husband's funds went over into alleged safe accounts that they weren't so safe, that they were based in the UAE, that the victims were advised that a fraud was taking place. In actual fact, the fraud was taking place during them transferring the £700,000 into safe accounts. And even this was a joint FCA and NCA alleged investigation. So even law enforcement are susceptible to being cloned, hijacked, misrepresented in this way.
It was an awful, awful case to read. If anybody, both in the legal and financial services sector, reads that one, how much a fraudster can get their hooks into a customer to really socially engineer and have control of the narrative. You want to read it? It's awful.
Yeah, and I think that there were investigations, but the money was essentially gone. So the argument was that the bank had breached its duty of care, and that more interrogation and questioning around the transfer should have taken place at the time, and the circumstances should have been red flag. However, it was held that the duty of care did not extend to APPs, yeah. And the bank was not liable to reimburse the victim.
It was a summary judgment, wasn't it? And yes, there was short shrift for that kind of argument. So Barclays successfully defended that one. I mean, this is a case where I think they had members of the police and members of the victim's family going round to try and persuade them that this was a scam. And that didn't, on the first attempt at that, it didn't work. So this is how much the narrative can be taken over by the fraudster.
Absolutely. If we move on to the next slide, so that these are high-level financial crime topics that are currently, you will have seen in the media, and it appears that if during this period, where possible, law enforcement are cracking down on the more high-level financial crime involving export controls, sanctions, and so on. So export controls, under the Export Control Order 2008, certain goods are subject to strict export controls, including aircraft, technology, and weapons. Some goods require licenses to be exported. The criminal implications of contravening this kind of legislation, the most serious penalty is a prison sentence of up to 10 years or an unlimited fine or both on conviction on indictment where there is a deliberate breach of the regulations or an evasion of the prohibition. If we move on to the next slide, please. And again, sanctions, under the Sanctions and Anti-Money Laundering Act 2018, which came into force relatively recently, the 31st of December 2020, the UK is able to impose sanctions on individuals, groups or countries to prevent money laundering or terrorism post-Brexit. Sanctions and restrictions that are implemented against target countries, groups, individuals, and commonly freeze funds or prevent the use of financial services. If we can move on to the next slide, please. And a recent case study of this you will have seen in the media over recent weeks was with regard to the Foreign Secretary and Myanmar and the Minister of Defence and the Minister and Deputy Minister for Home Affairs and freezing assets and imposing travel bans for their roles in serious human rights violations during the coup. Next slide, please. Sanctions and PEPs, again, this can have a direct effect upon those in financial services, knowingly or unknowingly. So for sanctions to be revoked in the first instance, the minister must no longer have reasonable grounds to suspect the person is an involved person and no longer considers a designation appropriate. We also have politically exposed persons who have interactions with financial services and lawyers. They're also considered high risk. They're usually someone who has a prominent public function, for instance, a head of state, a member of parliament. A list of PEPs are not published in the same way as sanctions lists, but can be screened as part of due diligence undertaken by organisations. And financial services have to be particularly vigilant in this area, as you just don't know the provenance of monies in certain instances, and there is a lot of cross-jurisdictional activity at the moment, although there are travel bans and travel restrictions, and that can cause implications for international relations. There are sophisticated mechanisms of getting around this.
I think that's right to say, Fran. I think there have been some more Belarus sanctions, both in the UK and the US, on particular individuals, most of whom are government appointees. I think David's just asked a question, Fran, on the Barclays app scam case. Quincecare was, as you'd expect, extensively discussed. And kind of interesting thoughts on the limitation around the kind of general duty of care to make payments versus the duty of the bank to look for fraud and misconduct in particular circumstances. And that's extensively discussed in the judgment.
Yeah, and these slides will be circulated together with the recording for those that have registered for this session. Moving on to suspicious activity reports, commonly known as SARs, again directly affecting financial services and those in law. They're a tool normally used by professional services firms to alert law enforcement to potential money laundering and terrorist financing. Regulated persons are required under the Proceeds of Crime Act and the Terrorism Act 2000 to submit a SAR in certain circumstances. Interestingly, in 2019, moving into 2020, the NCA's UK Financial Intelligence Unit received more than 570,000 SARs, with 170 million denied to suspected criminals as a result. That was a 31% increase on the year before. This week, it was revealed that the UK universities had accepted 52 million in banknotes from students from high-risk countries, raising suspicions of money laundering. Only 24 out of 478,000 SARs filed to the NCA were from the education sector in 2018-19. And interestingly, SARs in general largely are made by those in banking institutions. Next slide, please. So our next poll question, if you go to slido.com, And input hashtag FinCrime. Have you or your organisation submitted a SAR since the start of the COVID-19 pandemic? So as a bank, as a law firm, or any other financial institution, have you found it necessary to submit a SAR since March 2020? And we're split down the middle. Oh, almost 49% have, or I'll let it just rest there. It's probably around 46-48% of you have found it necessary to submit a SAR since the start of the COVID-19 pandemic. And it appears that money laundering is still ongoing, it is still an issue, and the pandemic hasn't put a stop to that. In fact, it may have enabled money laundering to be more easily facilitated with working from home and other changes to the working dynamic during the pandemic. So recent cases, and just in general looking at financial crime going forward in the future for financial crime, those of you in law and elsewhere will have noticed and will know that financial crime has slowed, not the commission of the financial crime, but law enforcement investigating. That doesn't mean that it's stopped, it has continued. And that there are various law enforcement agencies that are publishing recent investigations and court appearances to ensure that everyone is aware that this is continuing. Many of the investigations have been ongoing for several years. And with the rise in financial crime as a result of COVID and a flurry of high-profile charges and convictions brought by the NCA, the SFO or the FCA, it may be to act as a deterrent to those who want to be involved in or want to commit COVID-related financial crime and or any other financial crime for that matter during the lockdown when everyone is in a state of vulnerability. So recent cases, there's Ballysteel, there has been an alleged fraud, and that's on the Serious Fraud Office newsfeed. Next slide, please. Petrofac, we also have a guilty plea there in respect of a large high value bribery case. Next slide, please. And if law enforcement aren't seeking to prosecute, and those of you that tuned into the first session of the webinar series, unexplained wealth orders will be used in order to deter those from committing high value fraud, bribery and corruption cases, and any other such cases, using these as a tool to extract, freeze assets and forfeit said assets in order to recover monies that have been lost during the pandemic period without having to go through lengthy court proceedings. Next slide, please. And that is me finished for this morning. I'm going to pass over to Lord Bernard Hogan-Howe, the advisor to Rosenblatt's financial crime team. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fran. I just want to follow up on many of the areas that Fran's been discussing. And really, first of all, just set a bit of context about financial crime at the moment. And then secondly, talk about how both law enforcement and individual financial organisations might approach this in the near future, given that many are already sensitised to the problem, but it needs constant, I think, dynamic change to make sure that you're adapting as quickly as the people who are involved in financial crime. In terms of the context, and then we know that obviously COVID has driven two things, obviously people's working environment, and as importantly, the economic situation. And both of those cause particular pressures in this area. So one is that obviously people like law enforcement have had their operational rhythms changed. So they are concentrating on different things. Some crime types have reduced, violence in pubs and clubs, for example. But things like online fraud have gone up. Domestic violence has increased, but has been hidden away. Secondly, obviously, the police in particular have seen a 20,000 officer reduction over the last few years. They're in the process of recruiting, but aren't yet back to where they were. And finally, of course, there's an overall need for the system to resume business. We need the economy and tax taking to increase over the next year or so. But at the moment, that's not the case. But it poses great pressures in the system to make sure that business continues to function. Because, of course, people need employment. We need to make profits, and we need to tax those profits to make sure that the state can still function. So quite a lot of pressure in a system that's already working at a quieter pace. In terms of different financial crime types, then it seems to me it's always worth keeping an eye on the types of crime that we're talking about here. First, as Fran's already mentioned about corruption, this is probably more to do with what we see abroad than at home, but we do see cases in the UK. But what I suppose it brings us back to is the fact that when you're operating a financial institution, then the three big things to keep an eye on are always, where are you trading, the place, what is the product you're trading in, and who's the client, what's the due diligence about that person. And there are certain types of product which are more risky, and I just wanted to mention in a couple of areas things that are worth keeping an eye out for. So first of all, we talked about corruption, and are the people involved, are they PEPs? And even if they're not PEPs, are the people with access to power? And might they be influenced by money? And it's not only them, of course, it's the people related to them, particularly families. And that can be quite hard to keep track on in various jurisdictions. Secondly, money laundering, which is often, organised crime remains a cash business, particularly drugs. And drugs, in certainly the UK, remains 90% of organised crime. It's a tradable commodity. It's an illegal commodity. And the profits are huge. But usually it is traded around cash. There are not many people who trade through their bank to buy heroin. So therefore, one has to keep an eye on cash-laden businesses to see whether or not money is being transmitted through them. In terms of terrorism, that's a constant challenge. We've seen less terrorism around the world during lockdowns because the terrorists can't travel in the same way that none of us can travel. However, we can anticipate that people are planning for when the lockdown is eased. And they still need money to be moved around, not necessarily large sums, but certainly by working with the state, then it's possible for financial institutions to keep an eye on the types of people and the sorts of organisations that might facilitate the transmission of money. And that includes, sadly, people like charities. That charities trading internationally can be manipulated and utilised by terrorists and terrorist organisations. And the sanctions area is getting complicated for all the reasons that Fran and Tom have mentioned, which is not only to do with the fact that there are United Nations will change the sanction regime regularly for obvious reasons, and we've heard of Myanmar has been just one example of that, but also each individual country can impose its own sanctions. The UK has imposed sanctions in this case, but America is a big driver of sanctions, which often are to do with America's interests, not necessarily also to do with the United Nations assessment of where sanctions should lie. And I think finally, one thing that can cause financial institutions a real challenge is when they're dealing with tax. What we know is that tax avoidance is okay, i.e. everyone tries to reduce their commitment to tax, but tax avoidance is not. And of course, in facilitating tax avoidance, that would be a criminal event. And it's quite hard for any financial institution or a lawyer advising to distinguish between the two, particularly in some jurisdictions which are low taxation areas. So the things that people put in place, obviously the state puts in place, are, as Fran mentioned, SARS. And you saw the large numbers, 500,000 in the UK in a year. The great joy of that is, of course, it means that financial institutions have warned the authorities they believe that there may be some money laundering or other types of financial crime involved. The great difficulty for the law enforcement agencies is the volume of those SARs, because each one could demand an investigation, or it may just be an innocent transaction that appears for some reason to be suspicious. The UK has led in terms of creating something called GIMLET, the Joint Intelligence Sharing Arrangement, and that is the best really that I'm aware of in the world in terms of organisations sitting down and sharing data on live cases. Where it's not as good is it's not really at industrial pace. Now, we do see other parts of the world, Holland and Italy in particular, which are sharing mass data within the financial regulation system to monitor transactions and try and spot bad patterns. You understand that obviously there are billions of transactions around the world, and spotting a bad transaction in the middle of that is quite hard. But by applying AI to data, then I think Holland and Italy certainly are making progress there, and possibly something that all of us could learn from. I think the third area that I want to talk about is really, well, how do financial institutions protect themselves against being involved in financial crime? It's entirely possible for it to happen innocently. But of course, what you can show is that if you show good, you've taken reasonable measures to stop getting involved in financial crime, then this is a good defence. You can't stop all of it, but you certainly don't want to facilitate it. You certainly don't want to facilitate it on a large scale. And my work with commerce has shown that, first of all, the training of staff is essential. Yes, you can have AI in place. Yes, you can have good software. But making sure that frontline staff in particular are aware of their responsibilities, what to look out for, and the old things still work. You know, due diligence about a customer, knowing fully about their financial circumstances, and making sure you really understand, is the person who you're talking to, is that the beneficial owner of the company, or is in fact it a front person? And so these old systems of making sure that staff are aware are good, even when, as we know now, many of the clients are online presences. They are onboarded online. They often don't go into a financial institution at all. So it really does pose a burden on the financial institution, though not about that company, particularly, or an individual, before they're onboarded, because sometimes they may never meet, and companies have had to adapt their mechanisms for due diligence to accommodate that virtual world. And I think it is vitally important. The second thing is, does a company, particularly when it's a large one spread over multi-jurisdictions, does it hold all its intelligence in one place? It can often find that, in fact, one part of, say, a big bank may know a client in one jurisdiction, say for a loan, and in another, it may be banking that business just because it's how it transacts its business, as it makes sales and it buys supplies. But do different parts of that organisation, are they aware of exactly what's happening in the other part of their own organisation? The financial system is not, in my view, as good as the insurance sector in sharing intelligence between competitors. And you might say, well, why would they? But of course, what insurance found was that by sharing data on potential claims, they spotted dual applications for the same event very quickly, and that really helped them. And the financial system has not been as good as that, both within one jurisdiction or across the world. So it remains a big challenge. How do you share intelligence within an organisation? And are you sure that you've actually got a good hold on all your customers' transactions, regardless of where they come into contact with your own organisation? And the third area I want to talk about was insider threat. One of the things that, yeah, having been with the Metropolitan Police and previously with Merseyside Police, we had our own team who covertly and overtly monitored our own staff. We did that because we knew that we got potential and we were attacked from time to time by organised criminals. And the number of people who might be corrupt in your own organisation is usually fairly small, but you do need to spot them as quickly as possible. And the difficulty can be that your own colleagues will tell you that they are worried about someone's behaviour. The question is whether a local branch manager, whether a local part of your organisation, can they actually go away and investigate what you've just been given? Because otherwise, you may have a piece of intelligence which has no value, in the sense that it may be inaccurate. Somebody's been worried about seeing somebody meeting someone, and in fact, it's entirely innocent. But if that is a sign of something that's a problem, then presumably you need to do something about it. Have you got actually an investigation capacity and a response capacity? Things like drug testing of staff is something that can be contentious, but also can spot problems, not from the point of view of making a criminal charge necessarily, but certainly seeing whether they're vulnerable to someone else from the outside targeting them. And I think there are things like this which are reasonable to put in place to make sure that you have a defensible system that will help you to stop getting involved in financial crime, or if you do get involved, to stop it and spot it and stop it as quickly as possible. But it's not easy. And the insider threat, particularly, I would argue, I think in the smaller countries, can be a real challenge. So in some very small countries, which are low tax areas, and some might say tax havens, you have very low population numbers. So the people who work in the financial institutions are very available for local criminals through their families, through intimidation, through many reasons. And it's not as easy to, whether it be to be a police officer in a small area with a small population, or to be a banking official who's prepared to stand up to some of these people and make sure that you're doing the right thing. So I think, and of course, what you do see is that people trade in these low tax havens for the very reason they are low tax havens, which makes it also difficult for these small places to spot sometimes the unusual, but also to do due diligence about somebody who might be transacting from the Far East through the tax haven and then, let's say, into America or into the South Americas. This is quite a complex area, and sometimes some of our biggest international organisations have the least investment in terms of due diligence, in terms of what I would regard as some of the particularly difficult places to provide a service and make sure that you're not getting involved in financial crime. So I think just finally, I just wanted to say that it seems to me just a few words about the future. So one I've tried to highlight what I think is the context in which financial crime is operating at the moment. I've said something about how law enforcement is challenged, and also something about financial institutions and how they might make sure that they do their very best to not get involved in financial crime. But really, I would say that there are two things in the future that are going to make a difference. So one is the culture of the organisation in which you work. Is it one which actually is entirely down to making a profit? Is everybody incentivised to do only that? Or are they also incentivised to call out when they are worried about a particular client? I think the airline industry has got a really good system of allowing people to, without any blame attached, to highlight that they made a mistake. And as a consequence, an aeroplane could have crashed. That's a really good system that stood the airline industry in an awful lot of, which really helped improve safety over the years. But are we confident in any organisation in which we work that people feel able to do that in our organisation? Are they able to say that they're really worried about a particular product? Are they really worried about the way we're making our profits at the moment? Or that the employee incentivised bonus scheme is driving people towards inappropriate behaviour? So I think the way that culture is developed and how you incentivise staff is a vital part of the future. And the second one is how you use AI. I think AI will be a big help in the future. It will bring its own challenges. The level of intrusion into people's privacy, into data, is likely to cause people some concerns at times. But I think there are ways to manage that. And usually they're about being open and transparent about what an organisation is doing, to make sure that a person has a remedy, a right of complaint, and if they have been wronged in any way, then there's a process for actually putting that right. And thirdly, and vitally important, is that there's some independent assessment of how that AI is working, so that there's an outside look at how an organisation is using AI, hopefully for good reasons, but to reassure people in general, and the clients in particular, that AI is being used in an appropriate way, and that it's doing the thing it said on the tin and not intruding into privacy in a way that wouldn't be supported by either the shareholders or the country in which they're operating. So really for me, that's that probably at this stage as much as I'd like to say. And I'd like now to hand over to Tom Townsend, who I know is going to take it further. Tom, over to you.
Thank you, Bernard, for that. It's really good that you finished on technology, AI, data, because as is proving in the chat, the meeting chat, that Dawn and Jane are asking questions about the sharing of data and whether it's good, and also asking about the regulatory environment. So we can come onto those in a moment. But you've both yourself and Fran have touched on that a little. If we could go on to the next slide, thanks, Emma. So I lead our financial crime team, and clearly at GT that leads us to interact with regulators on occasion, not just regulators in the UK, but further afield. I just got this slide in. It's a standard slide I have in, and you probably saw it last time, but we had a similar session, just giving you all an idea of the topics that regulators are interested when they are asking firms to do skilled person reviews. It wouldn't be too much of a surprise to any of you, I don't think, particularly those in the regulated sector, not just financial services, but in the wider regulated sector, that from a financial crime point of view, this is what regulators are interested in. And that's because these components here really are what make up the kind of financial crime, wider financial crime framework that exists in particularly in the UK. And these are the different elements that you would want to test if you wanted to find out whether a firm had effective systems and controls that were properly embedded. Of particular interest, that we've got transaction monitoring in there. That is, of course, one that is exercising people a lot. There's recently been a piece that came out of the Irish Central Bank, where they'd done some work on what were the topics and what were the failings that they have been identifying, and looks pretty interesting to me, and consistent with what one would find in the UK market. So if you want a reasonably fresh example of those kinds of topics and what they look like, then head to their website. I might post that on my LinkedIn profile later. Fran mentioned the Barclays case in my LinkedIn profile. There's also the Bailey link to that, although Fran has given you the reference there, if you want to have a look at that case that is particularly interesting from a fraud point of view. But anyway, these are the topics that FCA asked us to look at. We understand that they're not just unlike possibly the supervisory approach in the past, which focused on the systemically important institutions from that where there was lots of perceived financial crime risk. They are more interested in those firms that are in those second and third tiers, in particularly in the financial services industry, more than they ever have been, and they're looking at supervising at topic level, themed level, and then deciding whether they want to look further in those types of firms. So you can kind of they've kind of upended, I think, their supervisory approach a little to get, I think, in their view, more bang for their supervisory buck, if I could put it like that. Next slide, please, Emma. I think it might be a slide. Some of the topics that are out there, and just trying to answer or comment on Jane and Dawn's issues. Of course, data sharing is a big issue for all firms. I think firms want to do more of it in service of preventing financial crime, but clearly they're nervous about, first of all, data protection and making sure that they are allowed to share more information. This is both in service of the traditional money laundering, SAR, pre-suspicion type information that might get shared, and then there's the kind of fraud world in service of trying to prevent in real time frauds. And so there is definitely moves in the government and other bodies to try and encourage greater data sharing. But as I say, data protection is the major concern around what it is possible to share, what is sensitive, what isn't sensitive data, and what could be shared under the current legal regime. And then there's the question of, if we can't share data at the moment between institutions, both regulated and unregulated, and between regulated firms, what needs to change and what should the regime look like that both protects individual liberty and freedom in the sense of expecting your private data to be used in an appropriate way versus preventing financial crime in its widest sense, both money laundering corruption, but also fraud that in the app scam world hits real people, and sometimes life-changing events where they often, as that Barclays case indicates, leaves them without any recourse. That is a situation that really cannot stand, but we don't also at the same time want to throw out our assumption that we have some privacy in our lives as well. So there's that one would expect there to be some legislative movement, but that I don't necessarily think that will happen quickly, but the thinking is being done by I know there are lots of lawyers, including QCs on the call. Some of that thinking is being done as we speak. These are the kind of topics that are out there from various sources as to things that are changing. You know, if I was to briefly summarize them all, it's all about more collaboration and better use of data. You know, one thing that the FCA is very keen to say, not wishing to speak to them particularly, but they are keen to emphasise whenever I've interacted with them, is that analytics is great. As Lord Hogan-Howe said, you can use algorithms and some of the WYSI technology that's out there, but you've got to be able to explain how that works. And swapping out a traditional rules-based system, whether it's to do with customer screening, transaction monitoring, payment screening, and the like, you've got to be able to explain why a different approach to data works, and you've got to explain the outcomes and why they're better than the approach that you have shifted from. And that's not an easy thing to do, but that nevertheless is the expectation that you should be able to do that. Next slide, please, Fran. Improvement opportunities in fraud, very similar to the wider financial crime piece. Intelligence sharing, data sharing, more collaboration, better education of consumers. Education of consumers on its own is not going to do it, in my view, but it is still a part of solving for the fraud problem against customers, and by customers I mean bank and financial services institution customers rather than frauds against themselves. So these are the kinds of things that we're wanting and needing to see change, particularly around data and information sharing. Next slide, thanks, Fran. So you know you'll all be familiar with the APP scams that are out there. You know the numbers are ridiculous in terms of the level of fraud, and you know I'm involved in work with people like UK Finance and Stop Scams, which Stop Under UK, which I mentioned before, that is trying to kind of solve for some of these problems and facilitate information sharing or improvements in our at the UK level systems and controls to combat these types of fraud. Jane's got a comment on economic crime plan. Smaller regulated firms and financial crime vendors of technology need to be better represented with the Treasury by a body other than UK, which is dominated by larger banks. Certainly, it's worth mentioning at this juncture, it's very, very, very good point to mention, is that there are people like Global Cybercrime Alliance, there are various of the telco bodies that have kind of subgroups that kind of they don't represent technology vendors necessarily, but they are fora in which the technology vendors have access. But I take your point, Jane, that there is possibly a way in which that could be facilitated, and I'm happy to speak offline about how I might help with that. I mean, obviously, the people have different commercial objectives, and sometimes, you know, in these kinds of fora that I'm involved in, what the direction of travel is in terms of policy needs to kind of be sorted out before you get some of the commercial organisations involved. But it's not going to get done without the input of the commercial organisations you're kind of referring to, those fincrime vendors. They are going to be increasingly important, for sure. Next slide, thanks, Emma. Oh, a Slido question. Has your firm suffered an increase in frauds against customers or the firm itself during the pandemic? So this is focus. I mean, it doesn't just apply to financial service firms, and this is hashtag fincrime, but it could also apply to your firm as well. We, as I've mentioned before, we've had people who have had the modern version of payment interception fraud of quite large numbers, including during the pandemic. And so rather than this only being answered by financial crime people on this call, you know, you might have a view if you're a firm that has suffered fraud independently of being involved in the financial services world. So there's been an increase, it looks like, for some, no increase for others. As Fran was mentioning earlier, there's an increase in the threat surface for financial crime during the pandemic, greater home use of technology. But that's interesting. So there's some modest increase. That's interesting. Next one, thanks, Emma. Here's another one for firms that have suffered an increase. Has this increase been as a result of COVID narratives? But what we mean by this is if you've suffered an increase in fraud, or even if you haven't suffered an increase, but the reasons or the narratives around the fraud that has happened, have they utilized a social engineering that links to COVID in any way, to the pandemic? That's interesting. I mean, we're not going to quote any particular individual firm as to your answer, by the way. This is just this is anonymized. So if you see me on LinkedIn quote it, it won't be quoting any one particular firm. Not that I have done that previously. So has this increase been as a result of so-called COVID narratives? So there has been some increase, and 39% is not unsubstantial. We've seen it. You will see here, this is just a general slide about those measures of protection that firms use, particularly relating to customer data or behavior or access points that can help to prevent app scams. But scams in customers from a policy point of view, you know, what I saw a quote from the governor of the Bank of England when he's being questioned on other matters about his views on fraud. And, you know, the online harms bill is coming, and it wouldn't surprise me at all if there is greater pressure for online fraud and fraud against bank and insurance and financial service customers to be included in that online harms bill. Wouldn't surprise me at all. It's such a big problem. I think, you know, for what it's worth, in some of the trade associations, there is this desire to share data in real time in payment journeys. Working out how that happens is the difficult bit, but that is definitely on the agenda as to how greater information can be shared live when you're making a payment from bank to bank or bank to a third party to take steps to protect customers as much as can be done. You'll get these slides after. This is how we can help. There are plenty of things that GT can do to help you in service of some of the problems you'll find in the financial crime world. And I'll leave you to read that at your leisure. Maybe we can have time for some questions if you've got some time. I know some have asked them as they've gone along. What would you say are the key risks facing financial crime departments of a bank? Well, the topics the FCA is interested were on my first slide there. So that's a good starter for 10. There's a question here. I don't know, Fran and Bernard, whether you want to come in on any of these. There are major conflicts in privacy that do not just arise from Brexit-induced schism between DPA and GDPR. Question here, is ABAC the last of our priorities? I wasn't meaning to assert a list of priority on that. ABAC isn't always in the issues that FCA asked about, but it is in some of them. I've seen that directly. I think what we'll do, given that we're coming to the end of our time, unless anybody's got a burning question, is we will take these questions and submit some answers to the group. I mean, there's 200 or so of you that have joined. I'm sorry we ran out of time due to my lack of stewardship on the timekeeping. But we will come back to you with some of these questions and give you a view on them if you would find that helpful. Thank you for your participation and your questions. And as I say, we will seek to address them outside of this. And we do appreciate your participation, particularly on Slido. And there is a recording available for you as well. With that, I think we will close the meeting. Thank you so much for your attendance. I hope you found it informative. Thank you to Fran and Bernard for their excellent introductions. There are other sessions for GT that you'll see in the slides that you can come along to, including in this series. So I look forward to seeing you again at some point. Thank you.